wanting me to, inviting me to talk here. The opening batsman have gone. The ball has stopped swinging. The ball is turning now, and I'm going to try and tackle the turning ball like Dravid does. I just reiterate or summarize what my two earlier speakers said, which is very vital. High index of suspicion is needed for the diagnosis of SLE. If I may just summarize and say, when will you definitely suspect SLE? A young girl, prolonged fever without a cause, if there is any rash, hair loss, plus high ESR, a normal CRP, urinary abnormalities, and cytopenias. That is the clinical group in which the chance of you finding SLE is the maximum, and that's when you need to think of it. And in these people, ask for the relevant investigations, including ANA, and kindly do the ANA by immunofluorescence method. Don't use any other method, it doesn't give us the information needed. So once you've made a proper diagnosis, you've got the diagnosis, think in terms of the consultant rheumatologist here in Bangalore. You have quite a few people who have been exposed to these diseases for a long time, and they're doing a good job. So I would just expect a referral towards them, which will help the patient and you. I'm just, over the next 25 minutes, going to talk about the management of this disease. I'll first take one organ system by the other, tell a little bit about the management, and in the end, give you an approach as to how to manage this disease and end up with a few summary points. I start with the skin, which is the biggest organ, which is what you see. This is the telltale malar rash that our patients have. They can be quite extensive, they can be in the ear, they can be just seen as a few black dots. This is the discoid lupus on the scalp, which causes scarring alopecia. This is just alopecia, this is a vasculitic ulcer. As far as the skin is concerned, we are advising them to avoid excessive sunlight. Don't think that there is no UV rays early morning and late in the evening. There is enough ultraviolet rays that can worsen the skin rash and precipitate a crisis. Local sunscreens are given. Usually the SPF, the sun protection factor, should be above 40, and it should be against both UVA and UVB. Local steroid creams, especially in DND, to prevent scarring alopecia, especially areas, we can give local injections of steroid, which the dermatologist will do it very, very kindly for you. Oral steroid in small to moderate doses, if it is used for other manifestations of the disease, will also take care of the skin. We often add chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine, and methotrexate many a times to take care of these skin lesions. Azathioprine, cyclophosphamide, and thalidomide for very, very resistant skin lesions. And this is just to show you that the clearing can take place. This is a patient, the same patient, about 3 months down the line, total clearing of the malar rash, because it's not a scarring lesion, it's a non-scarring lesion. And this is a vasculitic lesion of lupus after treatment with cyclophosphamide, total clearing, so it can occur. So the treatment of the skin depends on the extent of the skin involvement, what the skin lesions are, and then you go ahead and treat it. Next to the mucosal lesions, which are not uncommon, they go along with skin lesions. Many times you just find erythema and a little bit of hemorrhage and an ulcer in the hard palate, which is often painless. If it gets painful, there is usually a secondary infection there, especially candida. So this is something that you look for. This is also a feature of activity of the disease. Parallel erythema may be the only clinical evidence of active disease. Candida may complicate the mucosal lesions. Normally, whatever is done to take care of the disease elsewhere, if there is fever, rash, a little bit of arthralgia, if you're going to treat it with a small to moderate dose of steroid and hydroxychloroquine, that will again take care of the oral lesions, more often than not. Only in a few cases, you might need to add other drugs, mainly for the oral lesion. But if somebody has a recalcitrant, persistent, painful ulcer in the mouth, please make sure there is no other infection that has come up, because you are using immunosuppressants, and instead of just increasing the immunosuppression, taking care of the infection might take care of the ulcers. Arthritis and SLE, both my earlier speakers have shown Jakut's arthritis, but my experience has been that it's more pain and arthralgia than arthritis, frank arthritis that you see. You do see a proportion who do get frank arthritis, but it's much less than what you see in rheumatoid and psoriatic arthritis, etc. Management depends on severity. If only arthritis is the major manifestation of the disease, you might even treat it like rheumatoid. Most of the drugs that have been used in rheumatoid arthritis can take care of the arthritis of SLE. So So often the NSAID, you might need a small dose of steroids, sometimes an injectable depometrol 120 milligrams, followed by either hydroxychloroquine, methotrexate, and even leflunomide has been used as far as the arthritis of SLE goes. The renal lesion is the most important. 40% of SLE patients at onset have renal lesions. 80 to 90% over the due course of a few years develop renal lesions. So you need to know a little bit about the kidney and its manifestations. I'm not going into all the details of the classes. There are six classes. It suffices to know that broadly you can divide it into two groups. One is called the proliferative lupus nephritis, and other is called the non-proliferative lupus nephritis. The proliferative are class 3 and class 4, and these are the ones that have bad prognosis, rapidly worsening creatinine and going up into end-stage renal disease if you don't take care of them. So in short, if there's one group of kidney diseases that you need to remember, it is the rapidly progressive proliferative lupus nephritis. Most centers, if the question comes about biopsy, some people do biopsy, some people do not. Please refer the patients on to a rheumatologist, and obviously they will also take the help of a nephrologist during such a situation. Biopsy is usually done if there is an active urine sediment. There is proteinuria. Apart from that, there are RBCs, WBCs, RBC casts in the urine which have to be looked for diligently. There is more than 1 gram 24-hour proteinuria nowadays. We may not do a 24-hour sample. We do a spot urine protein by creatinine ratio. If it is something more than 1.5, again, you are justified. If there is a low C3, C4, and mild to moderate rise in creatinine. So most will do a biopsy. The reason for doing a biopsy is, even though many times the clinical picture mirrors the pathology that you see on the biopsy, there are enough patients, maybe about 20-30%, wherein the urine routine and the basic tests do not predict the biopsy. You might have a very minimal change in the urine, not much raise in the creatinine, not a nephritic picture, not much elevation in the blood pressure, but still have a class 3 and class 4, which might progress an aphthitis. So if possible, when you're suspecting class 3, class 4 especially, think of a biopsy, and that might help. An important thing to do is both light microscopy and immunofluorescence studies, and that sometimes differentiates when a patient presents only with renal involvement without any other evidence of SLE. The immunofluorescence will help you between SLE and vasculitis. Treatment, I'm not again going into the details. The treatment depends on what type you see at the clinical progression. Class 3 and class 4 lupus nephritis, we are aggressive with it. We give even methylprednisolone pulses, high dose oral steroids, and the immunosuppressants. For class 1, we usually don't treat, just steroids alone might be enough. Class 2 and class 5, depending on the clinical picture and progression, again steroid plus and immunosuppressants. So what kind of immunosuppressant therapy we use? For class 3 and class 4, the whole therapy is divided into induction and maintenance. Induction initially used to be, and often in most patients still is, cyclophosphamide. Sometimes oral cyclophosphamide is more toxic. Azathioprine, and nowadays mycophenolate is also being used for induction, especially in young women, wherein we don't want amenorrhea and other problems to come up with the immunosuppressive therapy. And then maintenance with azathioprine, cyclophosphamide, or mycophenolate mofetil. Nowadays, we are using less. We used to give a 2-year course of cyclophosphamide, give 6 monthly pulses and followed by 3 monthly pulses thereafter for 2 years. We find that the side effects, including infection and amenorrhea, are pretty high. So we don't give that high doses nowadays. We try and give as less doses possible, possibly 4 to 6 pulses, and switch over to less toxic regimens to keep the nephritis under control. In the renal involvement, do not forget hypertension, which can cause progression all by itself. You need to treat it aggressively. In fact, they recommend a BP of somewhere around 110-70 to keep the proteinuria down if the patient can tolerate it. Anticoagulants, if there is any evidence of lupus anticoagulant, 20-30% of SLE nephritis have APL-related changes as well. So you have to be very careful, because unless you give anticoagulants, that renal problem will not improve. Need for dialysis is as usual, the criteria for dialysis is the same. It's important to realize that renal transplant can be done in these patients and they do well. Often by the time they reach renal transplant level, somehow their SLE becomes a little quiescent. and we have had about 6-7 patients who had transplants done, and we are following them up, and their extra renal manifestations of SLE seem to be quiescent. But we also have to remember that after transplant, a lot of immunosuppression is given for 2 years, and that may be keeping the SLE under quiet. You have to follow them up for much longer periods before you make that statement. Cytopenia is known. Dr. Chandrasekhar alluded about it. Important thing is rule out drugs. Some of the drugs can cause cytopenia. Rule out infections. Parvovirus B19 is known to cause sudden drops in counts. Check for a splenomegaly. Peripheral destruction. Bone marrow may be needed, because sometimes with active disease and cytopenia occurs, most often the disease is the cause of cytopenia, but you have to be doubly sure, because you need to give more immunosuppression. There are patients with aplasia, where the aplasia is due to active SLE, and then in fact if you immunosuppress only, then the bone marrow also recovers. So you have to be very careful with these patients. So bone marrow might be needed. High dose steroids with immunosuppressants, plasmapheresis, splenectomy in some patients. One of the disease modifying drugs or steroid sparers, which is useful when there is cytopenia, is cyclosporine, because it does not suppress the marrow much. Azathioprine, cyclophosphamide, all can cause marrow suppression, but cyclosporine is something that's worth keeping in mind. Central nervous system, I divide them into diffuse disease and localized disease. Diffuse disease usually needs more immunosuppression. Focal disease is more often than not due to antiphospholipid syndrome, and if it is positive, that will need anticoagulation as far as the CNS is concerned. Cardiovascular involvement is not uncommon. We get mild pericardial effusions, etc., which might be just left alone and observed. The pericardial effusion sometimes can be very big. On treatment, when this occurs, it becomes very difficult sometimes to differentiate from tuberculosis, because that may be a complication of your treatment. But what has helped me in such situations is doing a CT scan of the chest. If you get lymph nodes which are necrotic around the heart in the mediastinum along with the pericardial effusion, if the pericardium is thick on the CT scan, these features all point towards an infection more commonly than SLE, and it might be of use. Eventually, a pericardial syndesis is the best way to go if there is a large effusion. Important thing to note is constrictive pericarditis is rare. So if constriction is occurring, again think of other things other than SLE itself. Myocarditis does occur with active SLE. Severe tachycardia, arrhythmias are known, and treatment of the SLE actively also reduces the myocarditis. Liebman Sachs possibly is missed, but it's not that common as thought. And valvulitis is rare but described. The commonest lung pathology in a patient with known SLE is infection. Lung lesions are known, pleural effusions are known, but I still will say that if somebody's got a dominant lung problem, unilateral patch, etc., it's more likely to be an infection than lupus itself, so you will need to rule out infection. Pleural effusions are not uncommon. Interstitial lung disease and pulmonary hemorrhage is less common but described. There are subset of patients with just breathlessness without any cause. In such situations, we'll definitely not forget pulmonary hypertension, which is often missed, or something called as shrinking lung syndrome, where the diaphragms get very weak. You can pick it up on an X-ray. It looks as though the patient has done an expiratory chest. Infections are a very important problem, and they can occur with SLE at its active stage or during treatment, and becomes very, very, very difficult to manage. Because if you just think of, and often the SLE and the infections are active at the same time. So you need to know how to balance these both, treat whichever is dominant and take care of it. The causes are so much, because of the SLE, lymphopenia, macrophage dysfunction, blocked reticular endothelium, all these factors in active SLE predispose patients to infection, plus the drugs that are used predispose patients to infection, tends to occur in early stages. It can occur in any stage. Early stage, when the disease is active, when the immunosuppression is high, that's when infections also occur. Bacterial and mycobacterial infections are not uncommon. The differentiation between active SLE and infection is difficult, but there are some features that can help you sometimes. Most of the times, SLE patch, GI is uncommon in SLE. More likely, if somebody is on treatment, gets a GI manifestation that loose motion and fever, more likely to be an infection than SLE itself. So you will first treat the infection, and even if it then persists, then you will think of other things. Important to do cultures wherever possible. The role of C3, C4 and CRP. One value of C3 is not enough. If you have a baseline C3, you can follow them up. Its downfall and elevation will tell you where the SLE is. May need to increase the dose of steroid, very important. Once the infection occurs, there is a stress to the body. Many of us forget that adrenal crisis can occur, especially severe infections. So please treat the infection, but also increase the dose of steroid to take care of the SLE for the moment. Especially with drugs like rifampin and other AKT, it reduces the dose of steroids, so you might have to double the dose. So keep that in mind, don't forget that. When in doubt, treat both. And to be perfectly honest with you, even though we are at the cutting edge of technology in the 21st century, possibly 60-70%, we end up treating both aggressively, not knowing what is happening, and the patient improves in spite of doctors. Role of prophylaxis is very important. We need to think of it before it occurs. Don't forget pneumococcal vaccination. Don't forget H influenza vaccination. These things can be easily done. And so therefore, these pneumococcus is a common problem in SLE patients, so we can prevent them. Please think of them beforehand before the problem occurs. This is an important point, because SLE often occurs in young women. So the issue of fertility and pregnancy will always be there. It's a very social issue. Many of our patients don't tell their spouses about the disease. They don't tell the other family members. So it's a big, big issue. As a routine, we tell our patients that if you have any match or found for the girl, please bring them to us. We'll sit and talk to them and sort the problem out beforehand. Very, very important. Fertility is reduced compared to normal people. The chances of abortion is a little bit more than a normal person. Please remember to plan the tests prior to pregnancy. These are the usual tests that we do. We do a CRP because it might help if there is an infection during pregnancy. ESR rises in pregnancy, so it may not be of great value sometimes in helping you. Complements do not change in pregnancy, so you need to keep that as a baseline. Antiro is very important, I'll tell you why. Prednisolone is safe with pregnancy. Many of our gynecology colleagues also are scared of prednisolone. Up to 25-30 milligrams of prednisolone is very safe. It doesn't cross the placenta, it's broken down in placenta. Very important to continue that during pregnancy. And we've had at least over the past, since 92 where I've been in the institute, we've had at least 68 pregnancies, live pregnancies in SLE patients. So that's very, always need to have an obstetrician who's willing to tackle the patient. You might not know much, but more and more patients you start referring, their experience also increases. Sometimes it's a high risk delivery, we need to think in terms of early termination of pregnancy as soon as the vitality is reached. Antiphospholipid, second trimester abortions, you get that. It can occur with active SLE, it can occur even with inactive SLE. If the SLE is active, you need to give both steroids and anticoagulants. To prevent abortions, we start Disprin prior to the planned pregnancy. And Disprin has to be stopped a week before the delivery to prevent excessive blood loss. During pregnancy, if the patient has had more than one abortion, an antiphospholipid syndrome has been confirmed, you need to continue with heparin during pregnancy. Aspirin, heparin, or even just heparin alone might be of great use during pregnancy. Don't forget children. Children can get SLE as well. So it can occur as we've had patients as young as 5 or 6 with SLE. The clinical manifestations, you have a neonatal lupus, a childhood lupus. Neonatal lupus occurs in those mothers who are Rho positive and may or may not have lupus, but can more often they not have it. Congenital heart blocks occur. First time when you diagnose it, it's very difficult to treat, but you need to catch hold of it in pregnancy. In those who are Rho positive, you advise fetal heart monitoring, which is again a specialized procedure done by very few people properly. So that has to be done during selected intervals during pregnancy to pick up the heart blocks and treat them aggressively. This is one situation where you will switch over from prednisolone to dexamethasone or betamethasone because you want the steroid to cross the placenta and try and reduce the heart block. Bisolone does not, dexamethasone and betamethasone do. So this is one situation where you pick up, you need to change over, just like the lung problems in children that you get this one. Childhood lupus, all the manifestation as an adult, there's often a lower threshold for renal biopsy because renal involvement is a little bit more in children. Important to do this because we give steroids, it does stunt the growth of children. So be very careful and keep a growth curve and make sure that they are going to their potential height. This is something we are realizing more and more. In fact, in August 2007, we published our paper in JAMA of macrophage activation syndrome, which is very important. Here's a macrophage which has engulfed a WBC. You can see the multiple nuclei there, WBCs, these are the RBCs, and the small dots are platelets. This is also called as hemophagocytosis. It is a known complication of SLE and some of the connective tissue disease. Presents again, looking very much like SLE. High-grade fever, cytopenias, elevated LDH, but high ferritin and a low ESR. That's what differentiates it from SLE. ESR drops. This is due to uncontrolled inflammation. Very difficult to treat. We've had about 17 patients, and we managed to salvage 5 because we picked it up early and treated them aggressively. They might need high dose steroids. Cyclosporin is supposed to be very important in this, and also things like IVIG and plasmapheresis has been used in some patients to really control this problem. So I'm coming to the last three slides. I've told you all the usual clinical manifestations of SLE. So the principles of management, if an SLE, first principle is diagnosing problem. Again, I reiterate, a young girl, recurrent fever, rash, oral ulcers, hair loss, high ESR, normal CRP, cytopenia, urinary abnormalities, strong positive ANA, bioimmunoglobulin. That's SLE for you. Not all might be present, but that's the picture of an SLE. So divide it in your mind into mild, moderate, or severe. Skin, mucosa, fever, arthritis, sometimes pericarditis, pleural effusion. These are all mild manifestations. For most part, can be taken care of. Mild to moderate doses of steroid and smaller doses of immunosuppression. Only if they worsen in spite of all this would you give higher doses of immunosuppression. Renal involvement, CNS, severe hematological, myositis, these are all severe involvement where you need to be aggressive, otherwise you lose your patient. Use appropriate dose of steroid to control the disease. Never use steroid alone. That's one thing, because whatever you add, you can taper off the steroids pretty fast. So we used to give, the concept used to be give steroid, if it doesn't settle, then you add something. You lose vital time by doing all that. You increase all the side effects of steroid. So add another immunosuppressant at the very beginning and try and come off the steroid. Methotrexate in skin and arthritis, other immunosuppressants like cyclophosphamide, etc. and severe SLE. Always think of steroid-related side effects in the long term. Do not forget osteoporosis. The day you diagnose SLE, the day a patient needs more than 10 milligrams of steroid per day for a few months, that patient needs some treatment for osteoporosis. Do not forget that, otherwise SLE will go, you'll land with fractures. Watch out for infections at all times, especially in the early stages. Prevent infections. I don't think we're doing enough here. We're not doing enough to prevent infections in these patients. Regular follow-up is vital. Special precautions and therapeutic decisions in those with antiphospholipid, young women with pregnancy and child onset disease. But I think I'll just end with this. Never ever underestimate SLE. It's been a disease where we've had a lot of heartbreaks. It's a heartbreaking disease. But if you treat it well, if you understand it well over a period of time, I think your chances of success rate becomes negative. Thank you very much.